Dear colleagues, welcome to one of the most voluminous lectures of the entire course. The topic is the margin of the nodule, which is one of the most important signs. However, the inter-observer variation of this characteristic is the highest among suspicious features. This lecture serves as introduction to the chapter of nodule borders. So let's see the topics which will be discussed. First, I give an overview of some important considerations. Thereafter, I present the various forms of non-regular margins and try to place the importance of nodule borders in target systems and in differential diagnostics of nodular goiter. I will shortly present the importance of this characteristic in different subtypes of thyroid cancers. We follow the presentation with the differential diagnostics of nodule margins. We discuss various forms of ill-defined and irregular borders. The usual advices regarding technical issues, references, and others can be achieved by clicking on the button Technical in the web page. First, it should be noticed how a regular thyroid nodule looks like. It is difficult to properly visualize relatively large nodules in the same image all along properly. Therefore, video is clearly superior to still images, and only the former is suitable to judge the borders of the lesion. It lasted more than 10 minutes to find nodules to demonstrate typical examples of normal borders. I had to surf on dozens of images because almost every nodule presents some irregularities. And this difficulty points out to one of the most important issues which will be discussed later. There is no exact definition on normal and abnormal margins. Which degree of abnormality should be held as irregular? A normal nodule margin is characterized by sharp and smooth borders of its entire surface. It is to be avoided overrating small irregularities. The left nodule presents ill-defined parts in a small proportion of nodule margins, which does not reach an abnormal extent. The right hypoechogenic nodule is not perfectly oval. Note the almost sharp small protrusion in the medial and in the lower part of the lesion. As a simple rule, the nodule border refers to the external surface of the lesion, more precisely to the outer surface of a single nodule. So, external, single, and nodule. These features are the very essence. In the everyday practice, there are two situations in which we have to deal with internal borders of a nodule: in cystic and in heterogeneous nodules. The borders and the shape of the solid part of a mixed cystic solid nodule can have great relevance, but surely less than the irregular shape of the outer surface. Sharp protrusions in the surface of the inner solid part are not included among irregular margins. And similarly, the irregularities of the internal surface of a heterogeneous nodule should not be encountered among irregular nodule margins. The left images came from a mixed solid cystic nodule. Usually, as in this case, the solid part has irregular borders. The right case presents a heterogeneous nodule having econormal and deeply hypoechogenic parts. There is a protrusion on the border between these areas, but again, this is not on the external surface of the lesion. It is more difficult and not infrequently impossible to resolve the next issue. Is a mass composed of multiple nodules, or the mass itself should be held as one nodule? As a rule, the margins are referred to a single nodule and not to that of a mass composed of multiple nodules. In the left upper image, the judgment is relatively easy. This mass is composed of multiple nodules, which makes the appearance of the surface of the entire mass undulated, similarly to an individual raspberry, which is made of numerous droplets. So the margins in the left upper case should not be held as irregular. The situation is less evident in the left lower nodule. The lesion is surely composed of at least two nodules. The upper left in the image marked with yellow arrow corresponds to one lesion. However, there is a pathological ablation marked with red arrow in the lower part. The right uppercase is a micronodular form of Hashimoto's thyroiditis. The surface of the mass is undulated, but this undulation does not mean irregular border, because it is caused by the presence of multiple lesions next to each other. The right lower case is even more complicated. On still image, the lesion seems to have speculations and lobulations. However, let's see the video of this nodule. The econormal right lobe has a mass with undulated surface. However, the speculations marked with yellow arrowheads can be found within the nodule. The outer borders of the lesion are marked with red arrows. The mass presents another deceptive pattern. This is composed of multiple nodules. The ventral nodule is marked with yellow, while the dorsal is with red arrows. The presence of multiple nodules next to each other makes the borders of the whole mass undulated. The third basic feature to fulfill the criteria of irregular borders, margins are interpreted in the context of pathological nodules and not in the context of discrete echo abnormalities. This distinction leads to one of the most difficult issues in thyroidology, which is discussed in a separate lecture. I present two examples of Hashimoto thyroiditis. Both cases present discrete hypoechogenic lesions, which is the most characteristic ultrasound presentation of this disease. These discrete lesions usually have abnormal borders, they might be speculated or lobulated, see here and there, or the margins can be blurred, as demonstrated here and here. We have to bear in mind that only lobulated and speculated margins are encountered among irregular borders. Occasionally, the term infiltrative is also used for this subtype of abnormal nodule borders. Ill-defined or blurred borders are counted as abnormal, but not as irregular. The literature distinguishes between irregular and ill-defined borders because the former has a higher risk of malignancy than the latter. The left images demonstrate normal and abnormal, but not irregular borders, while the right pictures do irregular margins. The upper presents lobulated, while the lower case does lobulated and speculated borders as well. The real basis for irregular borders is the histologically perceived infiltrative growth of a lesion. On the other hand, it is very difficult to perform sonohistological comparison in the event of nodule borders, and I am not aware of any publication in this field. Practically, similar to most suspicious ultrasound characteristics, we lack a biological standard to which our judgment can be compared. In the absence of a biological standard, our judgment is based on consensual interpretation. The very basis of such consensus is the uniform and as exact as possible definition on which we can make distinction between normal and pathological forms of borders. As we will see, none of the guidelines give such definitions. One of the reasons of the highest inter-observer variation of nodule margins among suspicious ultrasound findings is that this feature is very exposed to technical issues. Part of these problems can be avoided. Proper focusing and the change in settings from better resolution to better penetrations are the clues. However, in obese patients or in large goiters, we cannot always prevent the technical problems. Another unavoidable issue is that it is not always possible to fit the probe all along to the neck of patient. In nodules which echogenicity is very similar or identical to the neighboring non-nodular tissue, the nodule borders can be also indistinctive. The medial part of the left nodule is blurred on transverse scan because of improper fitting of the transducer to the neck. On the other hand, on longitudinal section, left lower image, the borders are sharp. It is not a coincidence. Simply because of the anatomy, the probe can be fit easier to the neck on longitudinal scan than on transverse section. In the right case, the lateral in the upper and the lower part in the lower image are not clearly demarcated. Note that there is a dark field which starts ventral to the thyroid because of improper fitting of the transducer. So in this case, the indistinctive margins are caused not by pathology, but by technical reasons. As a final consideration, I only mention that the borders and shape of the nodule, together with extratidal extension, belong to the same family of suspicious characteristics. Each of them refers to the infiltrative growth of a cancer. After the introductory considerations, we move on to the next section. We discussed the different types of margins. We will focus on the importance of nodule borders in the differential diagnostics, their role in various thyroid systems, and in the most frequent subtypes of thyroid cancers. First, an overview about the subtypes of nodule margins. Basically, there are two important dichotomies. The initial task is to differentiate between normal and abnormal borders. Thereafter, we have to decide whether an abnormal border is irregular or blurred. We should bear in mind that the term irregular is restricted for lobulated and speculated margins in the thyroid literature. So a blurred border should not be called irregular. A regular border is sharp and smooth and lacks protrusions. As was earlier mentioned, most nodules are not perfectly regular. The presence of small irregularities is the rule and not the exception. These nodules with normal borders also present some protrusions. Note the presence of an undulation in this part of the nodule. Here we can see a speculation of minimal degree. Regarding the right cases, neither the ventral nor the dorsal part of these cystic nodules is perfectly regular. As a rule, the judgment on nodule borders should always be based on the analysis of videos and not on still images. The first type of non-regular nodules are the blurred or ill-defined margins. Although the presence of blurred borders increases the risk of malignancy, the very high inter-observer variation decreases the usefulness of this sign as a very suspicious characteristic. Moreover, ill-defined borders are more prone to technical conditions than irregular borders. This may explain the higher inter-observer variation in blurred compared with irregular borders. Four examples of ill-defined borders are presented. In the left upper case, the lesion has blurred borders in the lateral and the dorsal part. The left lower nodule has ill-defined borders almost all along the margins. The ventral wall of the right upper lesion is not well defined. In the event of the left lower nodule, both non-pathological and pathological forms of blur are demonstrated. The ventral borders are ill-defined simply because of the similarity of the echo structure of the nodule and the strap muscle. See the part marked with red arrows. Another form of non-pathological blur is caused by the wrong setting of focus, which hinders the correct judgment of the dorsal part of the lesion, pointed with green arrows, similarly to the set point of focus. On the other hand, the ill-defined medial borders of the lesion are of pathological importance. This pathological blur is signed with yellow arrows. From a differential diagnostic point of view, the lobulated or speculated margins are the most important forms of non-regular margins. The term irregular or infiltrative margins are restricted for these types of borders. The issue is again the high degree of discordant interpretation. However, both the sensitivity and the specificity are much better in the event of irregular borders compared with ill-defined ones. Irregular margins are counted among the most suspicious signs in all thyroid systems. Let's see some examples. Lobulated margin is defined as the presence of at least one smooth, focal, round protrusion on the surface of the nodule. The nodule borders in all of the four cases meet these criteria. Beside lobulations, three nodules present speculations as well. Speculation is defined as at least one sharp angle on the nodule surface. The distinction between sharp and smooth angles, i.e. between lobulation and speculation, is frequently not possible, but this differentiation has no practical relevance. I enlist among non-regular forms of borders a third type which is not mentioned in the literature. This occurs in multifocal papillary cancers. This type is characterized by a central core presenting numerous microcalcifications and isolated microcalcifications relatively far from the central core. Most of these cases cannot be categorized among irregular borders. Essentially, it is impossible to define the boundaries of the lesion. In the left case, the central core is pointed with yellow arrows, while red arrows point to isolated microcalcifications outside the core. The core of the tumor is marked with yellow arrows in the right case. There are a scattered number of microcalcifications relatively far from this core. These are signed with red arrows. This invasive type of border has a very low sensitivity because it occurs only in papillary cancers which have numerous microcalcifications. But the sign has an almost perfect specificity because no other thyroid disease displays this feature. Moreover, this pattern predicts that the tumor is multifocal. So I have modified the previously projected figure, adding the invasive subtype. Although the most important task is the recognition of irregular margins, an experienced investigator does not ignore the blurred borders, otherwise he or she would deprive himself or herself of the consideration of a variable suspicious sign. Although this section should have started with definitions, but this is not coincidence that this is not we mentioned at the beginning. Thanks to Hong and co-workers, the situation is acceptable in the event of blurred borders, since we have at least one definition. This group of investigators defined the border as blurred if at least 50% of nodule surface is ill-defined. This work is only exceptionally cited by those who use the term ill-defined, which means that most authors does not give an unequivocal interpretation of blurred borders. The issue is twofold. Although Huang and co-workers have given a definition on the extent, one can say that this 50% is arbitrary. Second, we lack any definition on which we can distinguish between a sharp and an ill-defined border, which means that we have no exact measure on the contrast between the nodule and the surrounding tissue. The concern might be even greater if we take into account the impact of individual settings on contrast, which reflects individual taste of the investigators. In my opinion, another experienced ultrasonographer would choose four other examples from the same cohort to illustrate ill-defined borders, and some investigators might not have classified the two cases on the left as typical cases of blurred borders. If we compare the degree of blur in the left and right cases, the latter seem to be more typical. In the right cases, much larger proportion of the margins are ill-defined. I have previously mentioned the issue about the definition of lobulated and speculated margins, which are presented in this table. The absence of the extent of lobulation or speculation gives a wide scope of interpretation because they do not address the extent to which an irregularity is considered pathological. This is the major cause of the very high degree of inter-observer disagreement regarding nodule borders. Three of the cases presented here are very typical forms of irregular margins. The left upper nodule presents both sharp speculation, red arrow, and smooth protrusions, yellow arrows. The right upper nodule has speculations. It is equivocal whether the left lower case has speculations or lobulations, but as has been mentioned earlier, this distinction has no relevance. The nodule in the right upper case has speculated margins. In contrast with these three cases, the situation is much less obvious in the right lower nodule. The issue is not the presence of sharp angles marked with red, but the location of this surface irregularity. On video record, it seems much more likely that these protrusions are not in the external surface, marked with green, but within the lesion, therefore these irregularities should not count it as presentation of irregular borders, which always refers to the outer borders of a nodule. The main issue of irregular borders is the inter-observer variation, which is the highest among suspicious ultrasound characteristics. This is explained by the lack of perfectly geometrical nodules and by the lack of uniform, as exact as possible definition on irregular borders. I emphasize again the superiority of real-time analysis over still images. Except for the left upper case, all nodules prove to be benign. All four lesions present irregularities of the margins. The issue is whether the degree of the protrusions reaches the pathological extent or not. I would like to point out that the nodules demonstrated in this introductory lecture are almost always relatively small because larger nodules are more difficult to present and therefore to use for educational purposes. In the event of larger nodules, the issue is even more severe. Again, analysis of real-time video is the cornerstone in the judgment of nodule borders. Let's move on the next topic. I emphasize again that only lobulated and speculated margins belong to the irregular subgroup. The range of sensitivity, it has the occurrence of irregular margins in thyroid cancers, is extremely broad, which reflects the high degree of inter-observer disagreement regarding the judgment of nodule borders. The presence of irregular borders increases the risk of cancer to 4 to 6 times. The issue of diverse interpretation was mentioned several times. We have to be aware of the fact that there is a significant difference in the statistical parameters between clinical and surgical cohorts of patients. The former, the clinical one, includes great proportion of Hashimoto's cases, which are only rarely candidates for surgery. I only mention it here that discrete lesions of Hashimoto thyroiditis are characterized by irregular borders in 30 to 60% of all cases. These cases are encountered among the clinical cohort, which leads to a worse specificity, positive predictive value, and a worse overall diagnostic accuracy of irregular borders compared to a surgical cohort of patients, which involves much less ratio of Hashimoto's cases. The considerations enlisted in this table have been already mentioned. I only summarize them. There is no widely accepted definition regarding blurred borders. This could be an important sign of malignancy because of the high sensitivity. However, the low reproducibility hinders the use of ill-defined margins in the differential diagnostics. Nonetheless, the presence of blurred borders increases the risk of malignancy by 1.5-fold, which could be compared to the 6-fold increase if the nodule is lobulated or speculated. No thyroid system enlists irregular borders among suspicious signs. In this table, I have summarized how the most important thyroids handle irregular borders. In two systems, in the AACE and in the European system, nodules presenting irregular borders are categorized among the most suspicious group irrespectively of other characteristics. Be aware that in contrast with other systems, the AACE uses only 3 categories. In 2 of the other systems, the nodule must be hypocagenic in order to be placed into the most suspicious category. This table presents a summary of the literature. Papillary and medullary cancers behave in a similar manner. They present irregular borders in around 40% of cases. Similarly to other suspicious characteristics, the occurrence of irregular borders is significantly lower in follicular cancers. Nonetheless, after hypocagenicity, irregular border is the second most frequent feature which is presented by follicular cancer among the usual suspicious characteristics. In the subsequent part of the lecture, we will discuss the differential diagnostic of non-regular borders. I will give an overview about the non-pathological forms of ill-defined and blurred borders. First, let's see non-pathological forms of blurred borders. The border is ill-defined if the echogenicity of the nodule and the surrounding non-nodular tissue are very similar. Yellow arrow points to those parts of the nodule where the nodule and extranodular area have similar echogenicities, while red arrows do to areas which cannot be clearly judged because of technical reasons. The latter leads to the most common non-pathological cause, to the technical issue. Improper focusing and inadequate settings can be avoided by careful design of the examination. However, lesions located in the dorsal part and nodules in very obese patients cannot always be made clearly visible. The proper fitting of the transducer is the prerequisite of gaining a clear image. The probe may not always be positioned exactly along the patient's neck. Occasionally, anatomical structures, scars, or calcifications might hinder the penetrance of the ultrasound wave. The left image demonstrates the latter situation. Be aware that there is a dark band starting at the most ventral part of the image. This is marked with red arrows. Consequently, the lateral border of the econormal nodule, marked with yellow arrow, is difficult to distinguish from the neighboring non-nodular tissue. The right case presents an avoidable cause. In this image, the focus was set to the middle of the nodule, red arrow, therefore the more dorsal parts of the lesion are not well focused and seem to be blurred. An acoustic shadow is the hallmark of a microcalcification and hinders the penetration of the ultrasound wave. This makes the borders indistinctive. This situation is demonstrated in these images. The acoustic shadow is pointed with yellow arrows. These areas do not belong to the nodule, therefore the borders should not be classified as ill-defined in this case. Now we move to discussion of non-pathological forms of irregular borders. First, let's see a simple issue, the influence of the anatomy on the nodule margins. In both cases, the boundaries of the nodule simply follow the arc of the trochea. In the left case, this arc is pointed with red arrows. The mirror of this arc on the nodule surface is signed with yellow arrows. Consequently, there is a protrusion marked with green, which should not be counted as a pathological ablation. The right case is similar, but is more prone to misjudging. In the upper transverse scan, it is clear that the nodule follows the arc of the trochea. However, on longitudinal scan, the trochea is not visualized, and therefore the two protrusions marked with green arrows might be wrongly interpreted as lobulations. In fact, the impression is the primary, the protrusions are only the consequence. This nodule seems to present irregular lobulated margins. However, the undulation is caused by the presence of an econormal nodule next to the hypoechoic one. This difficulty discovered lesion is marked with yellow arrows in the right images. The situation is similar to the formerly presented one. The impression on the surface of the hypoechoic nodule is caused by the anatomical situation, in this case by another nodule, and the protrusions are only the consequences. The most challenging and frequently undissolvable problem is the issue of a complex nodular mass. This problem is again highly exposed to different interpretations. I give here two examples of the same issue. The nodular mass has irregular, undulated, spicated surface. However, irregular borders should always be referred to a single nodule. So the question is, are these masses composed of multiple nodules, or this is a single nodule? In the latter case, both the right and the left nodule have irregular borders, where in the former the borders cannot be held as irregular. The most important tool to resolve such issue is the thorough and repeat real-time analysis of the video record. On still images, we cannot solve the problem. A very instructive non-pathological form can be seen after the aspiration of cystic fluid. This mixed nodule had regular borders before the aspiration. However, the borders became clearly irregular after the aspiration of 3 ml cystic content. Okay, this should not cause a problem just after the aspiration. But what if the cyst will not recur and we meet the patient years later with this ultrasound presentation? In order to protect the colleague and the patient from further unnecessary worry, it is worth noting the change in the shape of the nodule on ultrasound report. The accepted method of thyroid surgery is the lobectomy or near-total lobectomy. However, we will meet patients who were operated in a previous era when partial resection was an accepted method. Therefore, we will face with the problem mentioned here. A surgical procedure has a deep and permanent impact on the remnant. Scars, concrescences, fibrotic changes, alteration of the vascularization, the surgical thread all change the anatomy and might lead to non-regular borders of the entire remnant or only a part of the remnant. Both the right and the left patients were operated on diffuse hyperplasia on Graves' disease. The knowledge of the previous histopathology was of the greatest help to avoid overrating these patterns. Both remnants are composed of a central hypoechoic mass surrounded with econormal tissue. The hypoechoic areas are composed of at least two lesions and might be interpreted as multinodular goiters. They present lobulations and spicules. If we take the previous histopathology into account, the likelihood of being these areas pathological nodule is practically zero. Therefore, not a nodule, but a non-nodular mass has irregular surface, which has no relevance. The last one is, from a practical point of view, the main issue. More than 90% of Hashimoto's cases are presented by discrete lesions which usually have either blurred or puzzle-like speculated or lobulated surface. The issue is not the presence of irregular surface, but the presence of pathological nodules. The distinction between lesions of Hashimoto's thyroiditis and pathological nodules is beyond the scope of this lecture and will be discussed in a separate chapter. These two cases should not cause great concern. There are multiple discrete hypoechoic lesions. An experienced investigator will not misinterpret them as pathological nodules. Therefore, the puzzle-like speculated margins of these lesions have no relevance. I only repeat one of the main thesis. Irregular border always refers to a single pathological nodule. The left case demonstrates another situation. There is a large econormal lesion within a hypoechoic background. Such econormal areas in Hashimoto's thyroiditis are more often not pathological nodules, but presentations of those parts of the thyroid which are not influenced by the underlying thyroiditis. These areas have irregular surface. However, the primary effect is the infiltration of the underlying thyroiditis, which is marked with yellow arrows. The protrusions marked with red are only the consequences. So, irrespectively of the interpretation of the econormal area, the infiltrative process is caused not by the discrete lesion, but the surrounding thyroiditis. Another issue in thyroiditis occurs if you are not aware of the clinical presentation. A subacute, de Kerwin's thyroiditis is presented in the left images. This is characterized by the presence of hypoechoic areas having blurred red arrows, or as in this case, even lobulated speculated margins, yellow arrows. This pattern is not infrequently misinterpreted as a multinodular goiter with irregular borders. What are the main lessons of this topic? Irregular borders included only lobulated and speculated margins. The third common type, the ill-defined border, is considered abnormal but not irregular. The second one. Three conditions must be met in order to speak of an irregular border. Irregular borders always refer to the outer surface of a single lesion, which is a pathological nodule. There is even a fourth condition. There are many non-pathological conditions which make nodule surface deceptively irregular. These should be excluded from pathological forms. The last is the most difficult question. We lack a clear-cut and widely accepted definition on the degree of speculation and lobulation which should be considered pathological. Therefore, my recommendation is not based on a general consensus. A protrusion or undulation of at least 2 mm or more than 10% of the diameter of the nodule be considered abnormal. Thank you very much for your attention.